everybody. Welcome to your Period 6 review. Remember that this period is all about westward expansion, and it goes from 1865 to 1898. So we're going to pick up right after the Civil War as America starts to turn its attention west. First big thing to talk about whenever you talk about the West, obviously, is the natives that were already living there. A couple of major things that happened here. Remember a couple of big Indian chiefs, Sitting Bull, who was a Sioux medicine man. He was the chief and political leader of his tribe at the time of the Custer Massacre during the Sioux War. Then there's Geronimo, who is an Apache chief who raided white settlers in the Southwest as resistance to being confined to a reservation. And then there's Chief Joseph, who is a leader of the Nez Perce. He fled with his tribe to Canada instead of reservations, but U.S. troops came and forced them back to reservation. And Chief Joseph is the one who famously wrote the letter that we read in class called I Will Fight No More Forever, where he essentially talks about how the people that he grew up with, that he knew, the great chiefs he knew are dead, and there's really nothing more that he can do to fight westward expansion of Americans. Remember that Helen Hunt Jackson wrote a book called A Century of Dishonor that recounts the abuses, the broken promises by the government and forced removals, kind of like the Uncle Tom's Cabin of natives. But then the big one is the Dawes Severalty Act, essentially where America in 1887 offers natives 160 acres of land to farm or 320 acres of land to graze on if they give up their tribal lifestyle and if their kids go to assimilation school. And the idea behind the Dawes Act being the famous mantra, kill the Indian, save the man. Remember that the buffalo gets hunted to near extinction at this time. Also, Custer's Last Stand, the Battle of Little Bighorn, where General Custer, in one of the rare defeats in this time against native settlers, General Custer loses to Crazy Horse and Sitting Bull's 2,500 warriors. But then there was the Battle of Wounded Knee to attempt to stomp out the ghost dance adopted by the Dakota Sioux. At the Battle of Wounded Knee, you could call it a battle or a massacre, either way. A lot of natives die. After that, after you sort of get past the issues with the natives that are going to end close to 1890, whenever the census officially declares that the West has all been settled, you start to see where more and more Americans are moving out. And the reason why more and more Americans are moving out is because in 1862, we are going to get the Homestead Act that is going to give 160 acres of free land to anybody willing to pay a $10 filing fee and move west to claim this land out west. So all of these people moving out west is going to lead to a massive rise in farming. So in the east, where they couldn't get a lot of fresh food before, now you've got an influx of fresh food thanks to farmers. The only problem is that farmers living out west start to get taken advantage of by the railroad. Remember, the railroad essentially has a monopoly on farmers because they're able to say to farmers, hey, if you don't like our prices for shipping food, you are welcome to ship it on a horse and buggy, and you're probably not going to do that because the fact is that the food would go bad. And also, massive bonanza farms start to pop up in the West, which start to hurt the tiny farmer even more so. So what you're going to see is the growth of farmers' alliances, like the Grange Movement. Their initial goal was to enhance farmers' isolated lives by organizing social activities, but eventually, they start to work toward farmers' collective good. This is eventually going to lead to the populist movement, and in 1892, James Weaver is actually going to be a presidential candidate for the Populist or People's Party. He didn't do very well. He was a third-party candidate. Third-party candidates never do very well. But by 1896, the populists will have William Jennings Bryan on the ballot, and he will make his famous Cross of Gold speech as a Democrat candidate. Remember, William Jennings Bryan is going to run for president three times. He'll lose all three times. 1896 is just the first. But he's very, very popular now because of his populist way of politicizing, I guess. He was very good at speaking to the concerns of the common person, and that's a very modern way of doing things, and William Jennings Bryan sort of perfects that model in the late 1800s. But remember that he's most famous for his Cross of Gold speech, where he essentially advocates for coinage, for silver coinage mixed in with the gold standard, essentially saying that farmers don't have gold, and you are really hurting us by making gold the only standard. And he famously says, do not crucify us on a cross of gold during his famous Cross of Gold speech. The only thing was that this would have led to inflation, and farmers knew it would lead to inflation, but the idea was that if there is more money circulating, there is more money to buy our goods. But alas, William Jennings Bryan does not win. William McKinley wins in 1896, but we'll get there. At this time also, along with farmer unrest, you've also got labor unrest, and a great example of this is the Pullman Strike. So in 1894, Coxey's army marches on DC, demanding the government create jobs in response to the panic of 1893. But with the Pullman Strike, Eugene Debs, who is actually going to be, he's going to run for president like five times or something like that, as a socialist. So Eugene Debs is going to organize the American Railway Union, and he's going to have 150,000 members revolt when wages are cut by one-third. Because remember, Pullman was the name of the rail car company. They also provided living for the workers of that rail car company. But what they did was they raised rent, but did not do a corresponding raise in wages. So it was almost like a pay decrease for the workers. The outcome of the Pullman strike is actually not going to be great for the workers, as they typically are not in the late 1800s. Federal troops crush the Pullman strike. Eugene Debs, and not for the last time in his life, is going to be sentenced to prison. Don't feel bad. He'll actually run for president from prison in 1912. Essentially, what's going to happen is that this strike does not do a whole lot in the interim, but it's going to lead to more successful strikes in the future. At this time, you've also got a couple of different industries that are having issues or just sort of coming into their own. You've got the mining industry, which is going to actually get a lot better due to the development of the West. In 1858, gold is discovered in Colorado. Also, as you've also got it in California in 1849. And then in 1859, Comstock Lode in Nevada led to a boom and quick path to statehood. And so Nevada's going to become a state as well. And then you've got boom towns known as Heldorados, sprouted from the desert sands, but there's also going to be a lot of lawlessness, and these will eventually turn into ghost towns. And this is where a lot of the cowboy reputation comes from. Cowboys at this time were used mostly for ranching, but because there were problems getting meat to eastern markets before the Transcontinental Railroad, which is why cowboys went on their long drives. But the railroad, along with barbed wire to keep cattle in, is going to pretty much eliminate the need for cowboys. Most of the problems we've discussed so far have been mostly western problems. You see them a little bit, particularly with the strikes back east, but these have been mostly confined to sort of that blazed trail of the frontier that closes in 1890. Back east, you've got issues with political machines, with robber barons and monopolies, things like that. So that's what we're going to get to now. So when you're talking political machines, you can't really even get the phrase out without mentioning Boss Tweed. Boss Tweed was the head of the Tammany Hall political machine, and he was great about making money and getting his people into power. So he was the political machine in New York City in favor of the Democratic Party. He made over $200 million by securing bribes and manipulating the government through embezzlement, fake leases, padded bills, and things like that. His schemes were uncovered by cartoonist Thomas Nast of the New York Times, and eventually Boss Tweed will go to prison. But one of the groups that particularly political machines were able to target was immigrants, because immigrants, when they came to America from Germany or from Ireland or from Italy, places like that, they didn't really have a whole lot. And so the political machine was actually able to target them and say, listen, we will help you out and get you settled in America as long as you will vote for us. So again, there's a lot of worker unrest at this time. You've got the Great Railroad Strike of 1877. You've got future unrest like Haymarket Square, Homestead Steel Strike, and of course the Pullman Strike. But at this time, of course, you've got a lot of anti-Chinese sentiment.
It's been a long day without you, my friend. And I'll tell you all about it when I see you again.
And this goes back to the Transcontinental Railroad. Remember, the Transcontinental Railroad gets built 1862 to 1869. And this is going to be a massive thing. One, people are going to move out west, but it's also going to lead to, because the Chinese build the railroad and because they work for a lot cheaper, you're going to see a lot of Chinese people get discriminated against. And eventually that's going to lead to the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882.
How can we not talk about family when family's all that we got? Everything I went through, you were standing there by my side. And now you're going to be with me for the last ride.
At this time, I guess we should catch up with where the political parties are. So the Democrats are going to be mostly made up of Lutherans and Catholics. More recent immigrants are the Democrats. They oppose government efforts to impose a single moral standard on the entire society. And their Democrats at this time are mostly in the South and in the northern industrial cities. Whereas Republicans are going to be mostly Puritans. They have strict codes of personal morality and believe that the government should play a role in regulating both the economic and moral affairs of a society. And that's going to lead to the progressive movement coming up here pretty soon from 1890 to 1920. Republicans are going to mostly be in the Midwest and the rural and small town Northeast. And then they also are going to be the Grand Army of the Republic, a politically potent fraternal organization of several hundred thousand Union veterans of the Civil War. And they're also, Republicans are going to be the large manufacturers. But then you've got the Compromise of 1877, where essentially, in exchange for the government pulling their troops out of the South, Rutherford B. Hayes will become the president. And then, of course, you've got Plessy versus Ferguson. This will be in the 1890s, essentially, where this sets up the precedent, the Supreme Court ruling of separate but equal. In the South, you've got continued issues with sharecropping, the system that is still not very good for newly freed slaves, where they're having to work on land and they're making very, very little money and kind of getting taken advantage of by landowners. And then you've got Black Codes and Jim Crow, which is going to ban blacks from serving on juries, ban gatherings in large unauthorized groups, and it's actually going to even punish blacks for idleness, essentially not working hard enough. And there's also going to be literacy tests and poll taxes to keep African Americans from voting. Of course, all of this is sort of with the idea of the wealth disparity that existed at this time in what we called the Gilded Age. So the Gilded Age is going to go roughly after the Civil War up until about 1900, and it was called the Gilded Age because of the very, very large amount of wealth at the top, and then the very, very large groups of people at the bottom who didn't have a lot of money. Remember, Mark Twain coined that term. And the guys at the top who had the most money were guys that, whose names you know, Vanderbilt, Rockefeller, Carnegie, and Morgan. So remember, Cornelius Vanderbilt made his fortune in steamboats and then built a railway between Chicago and New York. He popularized the use of steel rails in his railroad. Rockefeller was the oil baron. He made a ton of money with an oil monopoly called Standard Oil that is eventually going to be broken up into a lot of gas companies that we use today. It'll be broken up in 1912. And then there's Carnegie, who used vertical integration. Remember, Rockefeller used horizontal, buy up all your competitors. Horizontal is going to basically own every step of the steel making process, and that was what Carnegie did. He was a steel baron who actually regularized or normalize the Bessemer process, which made steel faster and easier to produce. And then J.P. Morgan was a banker and investor. And these guys collectively came together to be known as the robber barons or captains of industry, depending on how you look at it. Because yes, they did make a lot of money and they didn't treat their workers very well, but they also gave a lot of money back to like public libraries and buildings and causes and universities. So these guys are a little bit controversial in the way that they're viewed. And the reason why they're able to do so well is because of a laissez-faire approach to government by the U.S. government at this time, which essentially said government hands off of business. But also, this idea within our society at the time of social Darwinism, that it's basically survival of the fittest. But this kind of flew in the face of what Andrew Carnegie thought about the gospel of wealth, which was essentially, if you are a great man, and a lot of times great meant your skin color or where you came from, ethnically, that can be, a lot of this has sort of a racial bent to it at this time that they thought was scientific but wasn't. The gospel of wealth essentially said that if you are a great man, you need to give to causes and help men who were not as great. So much of this time is going to be advocating for workers and the advent of unions like the National Labor Union, the Knights of Labor, against guys who were a little bit higher up at the top. So this has been our period 6 review. I know this is a lot to remember, but in general, the big things to remember: the Homestead Act of westward expansion, the Dawes Act that hurt natives a whole lot, robber barons and their control over business at this time, and the laissez-faire approach of the government, as well as the New South with sharecropping and Jim Crow and black codes. These are the really big things that I want you to take away from this. Only Jesus.